Happy New Year and good morning and welcome to the first online service of 2021. Usually the start of a new year is a cause for optimism and for looking ahead to what it might bring. After all that's happened in 2020 and in the last few weeks especially, anyone could be forgiven for perhaps not being as positive as they normally might be. So I thought it would be good today to begin with some words from Lamentations. Yes, Lamentations. Lamentations is a collection of songs or poems that mourns over something dreadful. It teaches us that it's okay to express our feelings about the state the world is in. And then right there in the middle, it turns our attention to the Lord and the hope that we have in him. So let's say these words together. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him. It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord. That is all true. Knowing the Lord in the midst of turmoil makes all the difference. And everything in those verses is a reason for our souls to bless the Lord. So let's sing our worship to him.
Bless the Lord. Praise unending. 10,000
The last phrase of the verses from Lamentations said, "It is good to wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord." I am not good at waiting quietly. I want answers straight away. And sometimes in complicated situations, my brain has a tendency to work overtime, trying to work out my own solutions instead of just turning to the Lord immediately and waiting for his answers. I guess we all have things that we do that we know are not always the right thing to do. And whatever we're like, we can always bring ourselves before God in confession and trust in his forgiveness and love. So we're going to do that now. Lord Jesus, yours are the seasons and the ages. Give us a new heart and a new spirit. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Jesus Christ, you are the beginning and the end of all that is, including our lives. Make a new beginning with all of us. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you breathe your spirit on all creation. Make our old world new again. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy on us, Lord, and let your forgiveness and love come down on us day after day. Lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Our next song helps us to put all our trust in the Lord, whose everlasting arms will always surround us.
We sense us more strength as our labours increase. To added afflictions we offer more mercy. To multiply trials he multiplies peace. When we have exhausted our store of endurance, when our strength has failed and the day is not done, when we've reached the end of our earthly resources, our
Today's reading is from Luke chapter 2, beginning to read at verse 41. The boy Jesus at the temple. Every year his parents went to Jerusalem for the feast of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up to the feast according to the custom. After the feast was over, while his parents were returning home, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but they were unaware of it. Thinking he was in their company, they travelled on for a day. Then they began looking for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." "Why were you searching for me?" he asked. "Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he was saying to them. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. But his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favour with God and men. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We're still in the season of Christmas, so happy Christmas. And I do hope that you have had a happy Christmas and are having a happy Christmas, even though it will have been very different to every other Christmas that you can remember. For Jill and I, our Christmas has been much quieter this year, but that isn't all bad, because it's given us extra time to focus on the birth of Jesus and not just to frantically do stuff. Well, Christmas is traditionally a family time, but let's be honest, lots of families find it quite a tense time. I don't know what happens in your family, whether Christmas is good or whether Christmas is quite fraught. But I want to think about families this morning. I wonder, at what age did you first express your independence of your parents? Did you do it by staying out late? By dressing in clothes that they hated? By hanging out with friends they disapproved of? Or, well, all the usual teenage stuff? Or was your transition from childhood to adulthood less traditional than the screaming and rowing so many people seem to experience? Mine was different to that. I was 14 when I first expressed my independence of my parents. And I'm not talking about doing something my parents didn't know about that. I'd done that pretty much for as long as I can remember. I mean, when I was 14, that was the first time I didn't ask my parents for permission. I just told them what I was going to do. As I say, I was 14. I'd become a Christian in November, and in the spring, I decided that I was going to join the church confirmation class with a view to being confirmed. I didn't ask my parents if I could do it. I just told them I was going to. And if they had resisted, I would have done it anyway. It was the first public, independent adult decision I ever made. I wonder, what age were you when you first expressed your independence from your parents? And what about Jesus? How old was he when he first expressed his independence from Joseph and Mary? Well, that's what this morning's reading is all about, and it tells us that he was 12 years old. Well, to us in 21st century Britain, 12 years old may well sound very young, and many people think of 12-year-old boys as children. But in Jesus' culture, boys of 12 were bar mitzvahed, and they became young men. So at 12, Jesus was a young man, and that year, when he and his family, and probably everyone else from his village, travelled to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, Jesus knew his own mind. Apart from the Passover meal, which I was talking about last Sunday, when he would have been with his family, he seems to have set his own course and spent his time in the temple, listening to the temple teachers and asking them questions. Mary and Joseph probably thought that he was expressing his new status as a man by spending time with his friends and travelling with others in their probably very large party. And it took them a whole day of the journey home to realise that he wasn't with anyone else. So back to Jerusalem they went and presumably looked for him everywhere they could think of, never expecting him to be in the temple. Jesus' parents were naturally hurt that he didn't think of them. But Jesus was equally surprised that they didn't think of God. After all, he was in the temple, his heavenly Father's house. Where else would he be? And that's the crux of this incident. Jesus is the son of his parents, yes. But God is also his Father. And now that Jesus is a young man and no longer a child, he is expressing his independence of his earthly parents and expressing his relationship with God. Now, I understand that completely, because in a small way, my decision to be confirmed grew from a similar root. At the age of 14, I became a Christian. I confessed my sins for the first time. I admitted that I'd got my life wrong. I acknowledged that Jesus, through his death on the cross, had died for me. And I gave him my life to be lived the way he wanted me to live it. And without realizing it at the time, my allegiance changed. Yes, my parents were still my parents, but now I knew that I had a heavenly Father and my allegiance had shifted to him. At first, this change was expressed quietly and personally. I began to pray regularly. I stopped swearing. Well, to be honest, I'd never sworn at home. I'd have got into too much trouble. But out of my parents' earshot, I did, and boy, how did I swear. I also became honest, and so on. But 6 months later, I went public about my faith by telling my parents that I was joining the church confirmation class. Looking back, I realised that I was nailing my colours to the mast for the first time, and that mast was on God's ship. In that decision, I became a young man. I wonder, at what age did you give your life to God? Or maybe that's something you're still thinking about. And at what age did you express the shift in allegiance from your family to God? Or at what age will you do that? Jesus was 12. I was 14. How about you?
Before we have our intercessions, let's use the opportunity of a new year to commit ourselves to the Lord once more. Let's pray together. God, our Heavenly Father, as we look back to the past year, for all that was good and joyful, we praise you. All that was difficult or caused us sorrow, we place into your hands. As we look into the new year, we commit ourselves again to following and serving you. Empower us and fill us with your Spirit. Help us to trust you for all that lies ahead, and lead us forward in the name of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Pray for those you know who are unwell due to the coronavirus. Lord, in your compassion, grant them strength and healing. In the day of trouble you answer us, O Lord, and you protect us. You send us help and give us support. Pray for our health workers. Lord, renew their strength in you, and may they be channels of restoration and renewal for those who suffer. O Lord, you are great and abundant in power. Your understanding is beyond measure. Pray for all engaged in research into production and distribution of vaccines. Lord, grant them wisdom and understanding and effectiveness in their endeavours. How can we sing your song, O Lord, in these strange times? We pray for your church, who longs to praise you throughout this strange and confusing time. Through your creative spirit, fire our imaginations to proclaim your unchanging love in new ways. We cast our burden upon you, O Lord, and you sustain us. Pray for all in authority who face difficult decisions that affect the lives of many. Lord, grant them wisdom and courage. Lord of life, in this time of crisis for our families and communities, our nation and our world, we turn to you in faith to seek your guidance and receive your blessing, knowing that nothing in all creation can separate us from your love, made known to us in your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. We ask this in the name of him who suffered the cross and rose again triumphant, and is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. Amen. Now let's finish our prayers by saying the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you for joining us today. And as ever, if you have questions or concerns, or just want to know a bit more about trusting in the Lord, our contact details are on the closing screen. Our last song is a prayer of thanks and commitment to the Lord. The words will be on the screen, but you will only hear the accompaniment. This is so you can use it to sing or to pray or to reflect on, as you choose. But first, let's pray together. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, whose years never fail, and whose mercies are new each returning day, let the radiance of your Spirit renew our lives, warming our hearts and giving light to our minds, that we may pass the coming year in joyful obedience and firm faith through him who is the beginning and the end, your Son, Christ our Lord. Amen.